Good morning, students. So, yesterday class we discussed regarding types of catalysis, mechanism of different types of catalysis. And here today we are going to discuss about mechanism of enzyme catalysis. What is enzyme? What are the characteristics of enzyme? And what are the factors that get affect enzyme catalysis? In last class we discussed. Now, today I will discuss about the mechanism of enzyme catalysis, means how an enzyme can carry out a reaction. So the enzyme catalysis takes place in two steps. The first step is, see, this is an enzyme. This is also called as a key and lock mechanism. So this is an enzyme, means the key will take as an enzyme and the lock will take as a substrate. Substrate means nothing but the reacting molecule. For an enzyme to act as a catalyst, the shape of the enzyme must be complementary to the shape of the substrate. Here shape means the arrangement of the functional groups. We are having different types of functional groups in reacting molecules as well as in enzymes. COOH, what we discussed yesterday, NH2, okay, OH, SH, like that. And these functional groups are having some characteristic shape. So the shape of the enzyme must be complementary to the shape of the substrate. Then only an enzyme can catalyze that reaction. Suppose here I'll mention one more enzymes here. Suppose like this, the enzyme is there. This is the shape of enzyme. Then this enzyme cannot catalyze this reaction because the shape of this substrate molecule and the shape of enzyme is different. So this cannot act as a catalyst here. That's why the activity of enzyme catalyst catalysis means enzyme is specific. The first step is enzyme combines with a substrate to form a complex, what you call as a enzyme substrate complex. This ES star is nothing but enzyme substrate complex. This is means enzyme binds to the substrate molecule where the active functional groups are there. Then we can get a enzyme substrate. This is an activated complex. Then this enzyme causes, what the functional groups present in this enzyme, this causes some chemical changes in the substrate molecule. And then this substrate molecule, that is reactant molecule, is converted to product. And what the products are formed? Those products will leave from the surface of the enzyme. The enzyme can be regenerated as it is. Means in the beginning, in which state the enzyme is there, in the same state the enzyme will be reproduced. Like that. In one second time, it can convert a more number of reactant molecules to product molecules. So the first step is enzyme binds to substrate and forms a complex called as enzyme substrate complex. And then this enzyme substrate, what is formed here, this enzyme substrate decomposes to give product, maybe one or more products, plus enzyme in its original state. This is the mechanism of enzyme catalysis. And one more catalysis process is there, what we didn't discuss till now, that is autocatalysis. So we discussed about homogeneous catalysis, heterogeneous catalysis, as well as enzyme catalysis. Then what is this autocatalysis? Still now, what examples we discussed, in all those we have taken a catalyst in the reaction. But in this autocatalysis process, we will not take any catalyst. During the reaction, what the product formed in the reaction, and that product itself acts as a catalyst. For example, take ester hydrolysis. CH3COOC2H5, an ester, and this ester on hydrolysis produces acetic acid CH3COOH plus ethyl alcohol C2H5OH. Acetic acid plus ethyl alcohol is formed. Actually, this is a reversible reaction. Now here I didn't take any catalyst, but one of the reaction product, what is here, acetic acid is formed. This acetic acid ionizes and produces H plus ions. What the H plus ions produced by this acetic acid itself acts as a catalyst. That means the reactions in which one of the reaction product itself acts as a catalyst, that is called as autocatalysis process. One more example. Decomposition of AsH3, nothing but arsenic hydride called as arsine. This arsenic hydride on decomposition, it gives arsenic plus hydrogen. This is the balanced equation here. Now, what the reaction product formed here? Arsenic. This arsenic itself acts as a catalyst in the reaction. Means, in a reaction, if one of the reaction product itself acts as a catalyst, such processes are called as autocatalysis process. Generally, during a reaction, with the time, the velocity of the reaction decreases. That is, the rate of reaction decreases with increasing time because amount of reactants decreases. But here in this case, with increasing time, the rate of reaction increases. Because as one of the reaction products as a catalyst, the rate of reaction can be increased. So in autocatalysis process, in the beginning the rate is less. With the time, the rate of reaction increases. But other than autocatalysis, if you take any other process, in the beginning the rate of reaction is more, and with increasing time the rate of reaction decreases. This is one of the characteristics of this autocatalysis process. So this is regarding a different types of catalysis process. So overall, regarding catalysis, what we discussed is, what is a catalyst, what are the characteristics of catalyst, what are different types of catalysis, and what is the mechanism involved in different types of catalysis, enzyme catalysis, characteristics of enzymes, there is the factors which can affect enzyme catalysis, and some applications of enzyme catalysis. This is the mechanism of catalysis, there is enzyme catalysis, and one more, autocatalysis. See, what are the commercial uses of this catalysis? Commercially, as per our syllabus mentioned, this catalysis process is used in the manufacture of ammonia by Haber process. In Haber process, nitrogen combines with hydrogen to form ammonia, and there we are using iron as a catalyst and molybdenum as promoter. And for the process to take place, we have maintained a pressure of 200 atmospheres and 773 Kelvin temperature. This is one of the commercial industrial application for the manufacture of ammonia, and that ammonia is used for the preparation of urea. Second one, manufacture of sulfuric acid by contact process. 2SO2 plus O2 gives rise to SO3. This is the major reaction involved in that sulfuric acid. The overall process is, first sulfur burns in air to form sulfur dioxide. That sulfur dioxide combines with oxygen to form sulfur trioxide. That sulfur trioxide dissolves in water or sulfuric acid to produce further sulfuric acid. There, the second reaction, 2SO2 plus O2 gives rise to SO3, is a reversible reaction. There, for the process to take place, we use V2O5 as a catalyst. This is one application for the industrial preparation of sulfuric acid. And one more, third application is manufacture of nitric acid by Ostwald process. There, first ammonia is oxidized to nitric oxide in the presence of oxygen by using platinum catalyst. 4NH3 plus 5O2 gives rise 4NO plus 6H2O in the presence of platinum catalyst. Okay. Thereafter, that nitric oxide is further oxidized to give nitrogen dioxide, and that nitrogen dioxide dissolves in water in the presence of oxygen to produce nitric acid. So these are the three commercial applications given as per the syllabus. Manufacture of ammonia by Haber process, manufacture of sulfuric acid by contact process, manufacture of nitric acid by Ostwald process. These are the major commercial applications of catalysis. So this is the second part of this chapter. Now, come to the third part of this chapter, colloids. What is colloid? Let us see now. what is colloid, what are the preparation methods of colloids, what are different types of colloids, what are the characteristic properties of colloids, what are the applications of colloids, all these we'll discuss here one by one. See, Thomas Graham's, the scientist Thomas Graham's classified the substances as crystalloids and colloids. So this is the classification done by Thomas Graham's based on as crystalloids and colloids. He has classified the substances into crystalloids and colloids based on the diffusion property. Means the substances which can diffuse, that means the solution of the substance which can diffuse through the filter papers are called crystalloids, which cannot be diffused are called as colloids. So the substances which can diffuse through the filter papers by filtration, that is called crystalloid, which cannot diffuse through filter papers are called as colloids. But this is not widely accepted, because later some experimental evidence shows that same substance can act as a colloid as well as a crystalloid. For example, if you take NaCl, when NaCl is dissolved in water, the same NaCl is dispersed in benzene C6H6. When NaCl dispersed in water, this NaCl can act as a crystalloid. That means the particles Na plus and Cl minus can diffuse out through the filter papers. Whereas when NaCl is dispersed in benzene, it forms a colloidal solution. One more example. Soap. Soap in water. Not water here, alcohol I will take. Soap in alcohol. Soap in alcohol acts as a crystalloid. Whereas the same soap in water. Whereas the same soap in water can act as a typical colloid. One more. Same soap in water. Even can act as a crystalloid also. That's why I mentioned here typical colloid. That depends on concentration. If the concentration of soap solution in water is less, then it acts as a crystalloid. If the concentration of the soap solution in water is more, then it can act as a colloid. So same substance in the same medium can act as a crystalloid as well as a colloid. So here, soap in alcohol acts as crystalloid. Means the same substance we can convert, means we can convert into crystalloid as well as colloid. That means here, the difference between this crystalloid and colloid is not the diffusion, the size of the particle. The size of the dispersed particle is less than 1 nanometer. Then it acts as crystalloid. And it forms a true solution. If the size of the dispersed phase particle lies in between 1 to 1000 nanometers, then it can act as colloid. So the term colloid means it does not indicate the solution. The term colloid is the state of the substance, because the same substance we can convert as a crystalloid as well as colloid. That means that using same substance we can prepare true solution as well as colloidal solution. So the term colloid represents the state of the substance. And one more term is also there, suspension. Now we'll discuss regarding comparison of these crystalloids, colloids and suspensions. So depending on the size of the solute particles dispersed, we can classify the solutions into three types: true solution, colloidal solution, or simply called colloid, and third one is a suspension. This is the classification of the substances this classified based on the size of the particles. Let us see that comparison. True solution. Collide. And one more suspension. Come to the first property here. Size of the particle. So this is the classification done based on the size of the solute particles, nothing but called dispersed phase particles. Okay. So if the size of the particle is less than 1 nanometer, that is called a true solution. If the size of the dispersed phase particle is lies in between 1 to 1000 nanometers, that is a colloidal solution. If the size of the particle is greater than 1000 nanometers, then that is suspension. So this classification mainly based on the size of the dispersed phase particles. What about nature? Nature of the solution. This true solution is a homogeneous mixture. This is homogeneous. Means where the solute and solvent can mix uniformly throughout the system. Whereas this colloidal solution is a heterogeneous system. This is also a heterogeneous system. So true solution is a homogeneous mixture, whereas a colloidal solution as well as suspension is heterogeneous mixture. What about appearance? See, the true solution appears very clear. That is a transparent or true solution is a clear or transparent, whereas this colloidal solutions are opaque, whereas suspensions also opaque. Maybe this is clear also, a clear or opaque colloidal solution, whereas suspensions are always opaque. Next, separation of particles. Separation of solute particles by filtration. Let us see some examples first for this. For true solution, an example we can take NaCl in water. Sodium chloride in water is an example of true solution. Whereas starch in water. Starch in water is an example of colloid. Whereas sand particles. Sand particles in water. Or dust particles in water is an example of suspension. These are some examples for a true solution, colloidal solution and suspension. Then now compare here. If you take NaCl solution and if you filter the NaCl solution by using an ordinary filter paper, is it possible to separate NaCl particles? Possible? Not possible. Take sugar solution and filter the sugar solution. Can we separate sugar particles? Not possible. That means by ordinary filtration, it is not possible to separate the solute particles from a true solution. So here not possible. Now, take a colloidal solution, starch solution. By using ordinary filters, we cannot separate starch particles from a starch colloidal solution. So here also not possible. Whereas in case of suspension, if sand particles are present in water, by using a cloth we can separate that sand particles easily. So by ordinary filtration it is possible to separate the solute particles present in the solution. So by ordinary filtration we cannot separate the solute particles of true solution as well as caudal solution, but it is possible in case of suspension. Now I'll take a ultra filtration. So what is the difference between filtration and ultra filtration is, the filter contains micro pores. So if the size of the micro pores is very less, they are called as ultra filters. If the size of that micro pores is more, that is called simple filtration. So now if we take ultra filters, through the ultra filters if it was this NaCl solution, then also it is not possible to separate NaCl particles. So here also not possible by ultra filtration. But in case of colloidal solution, it is possible to separate the colloidal particles from a colloidal solution by ultra filtration, because here the particle size ranges from 1 to 1000 nanometers. If the size of the micropore is 100 nanometers and the particle size is 500 nanometers, then the particles cannot pass through the micropores. We can separate them. Separation here is possible, whereas here also possible. So by ultra filtration also we cannot separate the particles of true solution, but we can separate the particles of colloid as well as suspensions. Next, settling of particles. Suppose if you have prepared NaCl solution, starch solution and sand particles in water in three different glasses. Keep the three glasses on the table for 1 hour or 2 hours. Then after 2 hours, if you observe, there is no change in NaCl solution. Throughout the mixture, same composition will be there. That means the particles are not settled. So the particles are not settled here. Even if the same NaCl solution is subjected to centrifugation, by centrifugation also we cannot separate NaCl particles. So in true solution, the solute particles cannot be settled by any physical process, either by centrifugation or by long standing like this. Now in case of colloidal solutions, we can settle the particles by centrifugation. By centrifugation process we can separate. For example, in a laboratory during some chemical reactions we can get some colloidal solutions like white gelatinous precipitates, and those gelatinous precipitate we can separate from the solution by centrifugation. On centrifugation the precipitate will get settled easily. So colloidal particles can separate by centrifugation. And one more example, milk. From the milk we can separate liquid fat by centrifugation process, and this process is applied in milk dairies. In milk dairies the milk is subjected to centrifugation, then the liquid fat gets separated from the milk. And in case of suspension, no other method is required. Here the particles just settled by gravity. Suppose you take some dirt water in a vessel and just allow the vessel for some time, either 2-3 hours or 4 hours or half day or 1 day, then after some time without applying any physical process, the particles will get settled just by gravitational force, because here the size of the particle is more, they are heavier, so the particles can get settled easily. So in true solution the particles cannot be settled. In colloidal solution the particles can be settled by centrifugation process. In suspensions the particles can be settled by gravitational force. Next, diffusion of particles. See here, the size of particles is very less, so the particles can diffuse readily. These can diffuse readily. Since the particle size is less, the true solution particles can be diffused readily. Whereas in case of a colloidal solution, the particle size is more than true solution, so the particles diffuse slowly. In colloidal solution, the particles diffuse slowly. Whereas in case of suspensions, the particles will not diffuse, they just settle. The particles will not diffuse because the size of the particle is more and they are heavier. So the particles will not diffuse here. They just settled. Settled down. This is regarding diffusion of particles. So in true solutions, the particles can diffuse easily and more readily. Whereas in case of colloidal solution, the particles are diffused slowly. In case of suspension, the particles are not diffused, they just settled by gravitational force. And one more. Brownian moment. And one more property is a Tyndall effect. So regarding this Brownian moment and Tyndall effect and its characteristics, all we'll discuss in properties of colloids later clearly. Just briefly I explain here. So Brownian moment is nothing but a zigzag random momentum of the particles. The zigzag random momentum of the particles is nothing but called as Brownian moment. So in case of true solutions, the solute particles cannot show Brownian moment. Whereas in case of colloidal solution as well as suspension, the Brownian moment is observed. So true solutions cannot exhibit Brownian moment since the size of solid particles is very less. Here particle size is more, so they can show a Brownian moment in colloids as well as in suspensions. Next, Tyndall effect. So this Tyndall effect is nothing but a scattering of light. So when a light is made to pass fall on a subject, if the light gets scattered, that phenomenon is called as a Tyndall effect. The best example for Tyndall effect is in a cinema theater, we can see the path of the projector light very clearly. Actually, we are not seeing the light there. When the light is made to fall on the dust particles, the light gets scattered on the surface of dust particles. Then as a result, we can see the aroma of light around the dust particle. And that appears as a bright path in a cinema theater. One more example. Suppose in the early morning, if sunlight enters into our house, we can see the path of the light very clearly. There, when light enters into the house, the light when falls on the dust particles, the light gets scattered. There we can see the dust particles very clearly as bright spots. So these are the two simple examples for Tyndall effect. For this Tyndall effect to exhibit, the particles should have a certain minimum size. But here, in true solution, the size of the particle is less. So these will not show. The true solutions cannot show Tyndall effect. Whereas the remaining colloidal solutions are having large size particle as well as suspension particles also shows the Tyndall effect. So this is the comparison of characteristic properties of true solutions, colloids and suspensions. Okay. In these, the major difference is size of the solute particle. Depending on the size of the solute particle only, this classification was done as a true solution, colloid and suspension. Less than 1 nanometer, true solution. 1 to 1000 nanometer, colloid. Greater than 1000 nanometer, that is suspension. Okay. Now, as per the syllabus, now we are going to discuss about this colloidal solution, simply called colloids. And regarding this true solution, we will discuss in one more chapter. Solution chapter is there, we will discuss. Okay. Right. Now come to colloid. So as you know, the solution is a homogeneous mixture of a solute and solvent. But this colloidal solution or the colloid is not a true solution. It is not a homogeneous mixture. It is a heterogeneous mixture. So this colloidal solution contains two components. The two components present in a colloidal solution is, one is a dispersed phase. And second one is a dispersion medium. Dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Since it is a heterogeneous mixture, we can differentiate the two components of the system very clearly. Based on that, it is divided into two types. There is a dispersed phase and dispersion medium. One simple example I'll take here. Smoke is an example of a colloidal solution. And one more example, cloud is an example of colloidal solution. Milk is an example of colloidal solution. Like that, so many examples are there. Let us see now. So what is a dispersed phase and what is a dispersion medium? Now this colloidal solution is homogeneous or heterogeneous? Heterogeneous system. Now in a heterogeneous system, the continuous medium in which another substance gets dispersed, that is called as a dispersion medium. The continuous medium of the heterogeneous system in which another substance gets dispersed as colloidal sized particles, that continuous medium is called dispersion medium. Dispersed phase. This dispersed phase is a discontinuous phase. This is a discontinuous phase. Whereas this is a continuous phase. So colloidal solution contains two phases. One is continuous phase, another is discontinuous phase. So the continuous phase or the continuous medium of the heterogeneous system in which another substance gets dispersed as colloidal particles, that is called as dispersion medium. And the substance which is dispersed as colloidal sized particles in a continuous medium is called as dispersed phase. So discontinuous phase is nothing but dispersed phase. Continuous phase is nothing but dispersion medium. So like this, two phases are present. We can differentiate them very clearly. Let us take this example, smoke. So what is smoke? Smoke is nothing but carbon particles dispersed in air. If carbon particles are dispersed in air, then we can get smoke here. Okay. Here, in carbon particles and air, what is the continuous phase? Air is the continuous phase. So this is a dispersion medium. Whereas carbon particles get dispersed in the air, so this is a discontinuous phase. This is a dispersion phase. So continuous medium is called dispersion medium. Discontinuous phase is nothing but called dispersion phase. Now take one more example here, cloud. So cloud is nothing but a tiny droplets of water. Tiny drops of water in air. So tiny droplets of air are dispersed in, sorry, tiny droplets of water are dispersed in air. Now, here what is the continuous phase? Air. Air is continuous phase. So this is a dispersion medium. Whereas, this water droplets are dispersed in air. So this is a discontinuous phase. So this is a dispersion phase. Take the third example here. Milk. So this milk is nothing but a liquid fat. A liquid fat dispersed in water. Liquid fat dispersed in water is nothing but milk. Proteins and other components also there in milk. So here the continuous phase is water. So this is called as a dispersion medium. A liquid fat, this is dispersed as a tiny droplets, and this is dispersion phase. So like this, colloidal solution is a heterogeneous system in which a substance get dispersed as colloidal sized particles of range 1 to 1000 nanometers in a continuous medium. Now here the discontinuous phase is nothing but called as dispersed phase, whereas the continuous phase is nothing but called as dispersion medium. In smoke, carbon particles disperse in air. Air is continuous medium, so this is dispersion medium. Carbon particles are dispersed in air, so this is dispersed phase, discontinuous phase. In cloud, tiny droplets of water get dispersed in air, so air is continuous medium, so this is a dispersion medium. And tiny droplets get dispersed, so this is dispersed phase. Milk, a liquid fat dispersed in water, water is continuous phase, so there is dispersion medium. Whereas liquid fat get dispersed in water, that is called dispersed phase. So these are some simple examples for colloids. Okay, so overall, colloidal solution or colloid is a heterogeneous system in which a substance get dispersed as colloidal sized particle, which is called as dispersed phase, in another continuous medium, which is called dispersion medium. Right. So this is regarding a definition and some examples of colloids. Now come to the classification of colloids. These colloids are classified based on different factors. Classification of colloids. See, colloids are mainly classified based on three factors. The first factor is the physical state. Based on physical state, and second one is based on affinity between dispersed phase and dispersion medium, and third one is based on nature of dispersed phase. Particles. So based on these three factors, the colloids are classified. The first factor is based on the physical state of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. The second factor is based on the affinity between dispersed phase and dispersion medium. And third classification is based on the nature of the particles which get dispersed. Now in that, come to the first one here. Classification of colloids based on physical states. See, except gas and gas, if you take any two combinations of the physical states, they can form colloidal solution. Because gases always forms homogeneous mixture. The mixture of any two gases is always homogeneous mixture. There is always a true solution. Except gas and gas, the remaining combinations can form colloidal solution. Let us see one by one here. Dispersion phase. And second one is dispersion medium. The type of colloid and an example for this. Dispersed phase, dispersion medium, and what type of this, what is the name of that colloid, and what are some examples. Solid. Dispersed in solid. This is simply called as a solid sol. Means if a solid particles get dispersed in another continuous solid phase, that is solid in solid type colloid, simply called as solid sol. Here a sol means colloidal solution. Instead of representing complete term colloidal solution, in a short form we will represent as sol. Sol means nothing but colloidal solution. Solid in solid called as solid sol. An example for this is colored glass. Colored glass is an example, and one more, gemstones. what are you using? Gemstones are example for solid in solid. Some two examples I explain here: ruby, emerald, which is in a red and green color. So this ruby is nothing but Al2O3. In Al2O3, Cr plus 3 ions get dispersed here. Ruby is nothing but Cr plus 3 ions get dispersed in alumina Al2O3. This is solid. This is solid. A solid particle get dispersed in another solid. This is an example of a solid in solid type colloidal solution. Emerald. So emerald is nothing but beryl. 3BeO. Al2O3, 6SiO2. This is the composition. Simply, you can represent this as Be3, Al2, Si6, O18. This is the chemical composition of beryl, a mineral. This is in this beryl. If Cr plus 3 ions get dispersed, then we can get emerald. So emerald is Cr plus 3 ions dispersed in beryl, a mineral. Ruby is nothing but Cr plus 3 ions dispersed in Al2O3. These are two examples for gemstones. Like that, what are you using? Colored glass. To produce different colors in glass, we can use different metal ions. Different metal composition is added to, means salts are added to glass, then we can get different colored glasses. So a solid get dispersed in another solid is called solid sol. Examples for this is colored glass and gems. Next, solid dispersed in a liquid. If a solid dispersed in liquid, simply it is called as sol, colloidal solution or sol simply. An example for this is starch sol, gold sol, sulfur sol. And so on. Protein, enzymes dispersed in water, all these comes under solid in liquid type, simply called as sols. So how you can get a starch sol? If a starch particles get dispersed in water, then we can get starch sol, simply what we call as a ganji, right? Gold sol. How gold sol is obtained? When gold particles, means when gold atoms undergo aggregation and a particular size gold particles dispersed in water, means gold particles dispersed as colloidal particles in water, then we can get gold colloidal solution. And this gold colloidal solution is used in the preparation of some medicines. Sulfur sol. Sulfur molecules undergo aggregation. Nearly more than 1000 molecules of sulfur undergo aggregation and forms a colloidal solution. What is the molecular formula of sulfur? S8. Like this, S8 molecules more than 1000 under aggregation, then we can get a colloidal sized particle. That colloidal sized particle dispersed in water, that is called as sulfur sol. So this is a solid in liquid type colloidal solutions. And then solid in gas. Solid particles get dispersed in gas. These are called as aerosols. Means in a colloidal solution, if the dispersion medium is air, that is called as aerosol. And dispersion phase may be either solid or liquid, whatever it may be. If the dispersion medium is gas, then it is called as aerosol. Now, for these examples are smoke, dust. Smoke and dust are examples of this solid in gas type emulsion. Sorry, solid in gas type colloidal solution, which is called as aerosol. Next, liquid. Liquid in solid. A liquid dispersed phase get dispersed in a solid dispersion medium. Now these are called as gels. A liquid get dispersed in a solid called as gel. And for this, some examples are shoe polish. What are you using? Shoe polish. There is an example of a liquid in solid. for the paints we are using. Paint is an example of liquid solid colloidal solution, otherwise butter, curd, cheese, all these are examples of, these are milk products. So these are some examples of liquid dispersed in solid called as a gel. Next, liquid dispersed in a liquid. If a liquid get dispersed in another liquid, that is simply called as emulsion. So emulsions and types of emulsions later we'll discuss in further topics. So liquid get dispersed in liquid is nothing but called as emulsion. An example for this emulsion is nothing but a cod liver oil. Cod liver oil, milk, and what the hair creams we are using. These are some examples of a liquid in liquid type colloidal solution. Next, liquid in gas. So if a liquid get dispersed in gas, as we discussed earlier, if gaseous phase is the dispersion medium, simply called as aerosol. If a liquid get dispersed in gas also, it is called as aerosol. So it is an aerosol. An example for aerosol is nothing but a liquid in gas, a cloud. Tiny droplets of water get dispersed in air. Fog, mist. Even if you take a insecticide sprays, so insecticides are sprayed in fields as a tiny droplets, and those tiny droplets get dispersed in air. There is nothing but a colloidal solution. So these are examples of liquid dispersed in gas. Next, come to gaseous phase. Gas in solid. If a gas get dispersed in solid, then simply it is called as a solid sol. It is called solid sol. A gas dispersed in solid. An example for this is a pumice stone. Pumice stone or foam rubber. Rubber foam is an example of a gas dispersed in solid. Next, gas in liquid. So this is called as a foam. Gas dispersed in liquid. An example of froth or soap suds or whipped cream. So these are some examples of gas dispersed in liquid. If a gas dispersed in liquid, that is called as simply foam. So this is regarding a classification of colloids depending on the physical state of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Now see here. So these they can ask in one more question here. They can ask what is an emulsion? Then what is our answer? Emulsion means if a liquid dispersed phase get dispersed in a liquid dispersion medium, that is called emulsion. What is aerosol? A solid or liquid dispersed phase get dispersed in gas, that is called as aerosol. What is gel? A liquid dispersed phase get dispersed in solid dispersion medium, that is called as gel. Like that, these terms they can ask as definition, and even they can ask an example also. Give an example of emulsion, give an example of gel, or even by giving an example, from that example they can ask what is the dispersed phase and dispersion medium in the given example. So this is the classification based on physical state of the substance. And even depending on the medium, dispersion medium what you are using, again the colloids can be classified in different types. There is a hydrosol. This is also called as a aquasol. Hydrosol or aquasol. Second one is alcohol. and benzosol like this. So these are the names given based on the dispersion medium what we are using. Suppose in a colloidal solution, if the dispersion medium is water, then it is called as hydrosol or aquasol. Hydro or aqua means water. Water is the dispersion medium. Then it is called as hydrosol or aquasol. Alcosol. If the dispersion medium is an alcohol, then it is called as alcosol. Suppose if the dispersion medium is a benzene, then it is called as benzosol. Like that, depending on the medium what you have taken with respect to the name of that medium. So these are named as hydrosols, aquasols, or alcosol or benzosol. So this is the first classification of colloids with respect to the physical state of dispersed phase and dispersion medium. Let us see once. So Thomas Graham classified the substances as crystalloids and colloids based on the diffusion of the particles. Later, the experimental evidence shows that same substance can be converted into true solution as well as colloidal solution. So that's why later the substances are classified depending on the size of the solute particles, and based on that we can classify the solutions as a true solution, colloidal solution and suspension. If the size of the solute particle less than 1 nanometer, true solution. 1 to 1000 nanometers, colloidal solution. Greater than 1000 nanometers, suspension. And among these three, true solution is a homogeneous system, whereas colloidal solution and suspensions are heterogeneous system. Heterogeneous system means we can differentiate the two phases in the system very clearly. So a colloidal solution contains two phases. One is continuous phase, one is discontinuous phase. That continuous phase is called as dispersion medium, and a discontinuous phase is called as dispersion phase. So depending on the nature, physical state and affinity, based on these three factors the colloids can be classified. Among that, the first one is depending on physical state. So depending on physical states, this is the classification still now whatever we discussed. And depending on the medium, we can name them as hydrosol or aquasol if medium is water, alcosol if medium is alcohol, benzosol if medium is alcohol. So this is for today's class. In tomorrow class, we'll discuss the remaining two types of classification. Okay.